Hello and welcome to Bealtaine at Home, and thank you so much for joining us this evening. My name is Tara Byrne and I'm the Artistic Director of the annual Bealtaine Festival, which is Ireland's national festival which champions and celebrates the arts and creativity as we grow older. The festival is produced by Age&Opportunity, the national organisation that improves the quality of life of people aged 50 to 100 and beyond. So this is our last week of Bealtaine at Home, truly the most unique Bealtaine we've ever run, an online festival, and it's gone so fast for us. I hope you enjoy it. It's our response to COVID-19, like many. And remember, there's events still happening right to the very end of May, and you can see all of that information on bealtaine.ie and ageandopportunity.ie. One thing I just wanted to mention is we always want to receive feedback from you about how you're experiencing what we do and where we can improve. So we're going to send you a link to a survey and we'd be really grateful if you'd fill that out for us. So to this evening, I'm really pleased to be introducing to you the annual Bealtaine Book Club interview with Michael Harding, talking about his 2014 memoir, Staring at Lakes, in conversation with RTE broadcaster and co-presenter of the RTE Irish Book Awards, Evelyn O'Rourke. And before I hand you over to Michael and Evelyn, I'd like to thank both of them in advance, of course, the Irish Writers' Centre, the team at Bealtaine, and our funders, the Arts Council and the Health Service Executive, as well as the City and County Council Library Association, who nominated Michael as our Bealtaine Book Club author. Thank you. Enjoy.
Thank you so much, Tara. And as Tara said, I'm Evelyn O'Rourke, and I'm delighted to be virtually interviewing Michael Harding this evening. It's my first time virtually interviewing anybody, so it's going to be an interesting experience all round. And I mean, Michael is one of those people where you say, you know, he needs no introduction. So it seems ridiculous to say Michael Harding, writer, columnist, author, award-winning writer, thinker, but I think overall storyteller is really the title given. So that is the introduction, Michael, I'm going to give you, which is one of Ireland's best loved, best respected storytellers. Delighted that you're joining us for Bealtaine, and we're delighted that your book, Staring at Lakes, was chosen as the specific book club choice for this festival. Now, we will get stuck into the book, I promise, in a minute. But, you know, like everybody, I've been reading columns during this very bizarre kind of last few months. And I just wanted to maybe just touch on that a little bit. And then, of course, we'll go to the book. You had one line in particular that you wrote that really struck me, where you wrote, "No lament or dirge can be sung yet for the hurt in the world caused by COVID-19. Do you still feel that? Do you think that this whole period, even at this close point, but is a time of pain and hurt, and not just a time when people are stepping back and reflecting and being grateful, but there's pain?
Well, Evelyn, hello, and it's great to be here, and thank you to everybody for being here, and thank you for making the book, Staring at Lakes, a book to be talking about. Do I think that it's had this effect, the virus? I think it's had three effects. I think one of them is to allow people to step back and reflect on their lives in solitude and to appreciate nature and the bigger picture. So I think that's one thing it does. I think the second thing it does on the positive side is that it has definitely helped people in a kind of a really refreshing way to take a new look at life in a kind of a deep way, at the relationships with their family and their children and their loved ones, and to find that, you know, people are sitting on the couch much longer, they're sitting down to eat meals that they never did for maybe years. So that's all the good stuff. But it would also be important, I think, without being too despairing, it's important to say that I think for many people it has been an extraordinary suffering. An appalling time of suffering. I've had friends who have had to, you know, bury a father in just terrible circumstances. You know, a father dying in ways that people would never have imagined that this would be the way we'd be doing it. And I think that there is suffering to do with financial stuff. I think there's huge financial stuff coming up that people haven't even yet begun to cope with or even think about, that they've lost businesses or they've lost their savings, or there's just a lot of suffering. And we're going to have to be dealing with that in the next 6 months, you know. But it's not like to be negative about that. It's just that's, you know, this is, yeah, it's a time of huge pain.
The word, and I'm saying this because I'm particularly conscious that we're talking in the frame of the Bealtaine Festival, and, you know, and the, what that festival celebrates. But this kind of new word, cocooning, that seems to have dominated so much talk for older people as such. It's a kind of cute word. I find it chilling in some ways. I'm just wondering, for you kind of as a writer, when you hear that phrase cocooning, what are your thoughts on that now at this point and that experience and how that's been?
Well, I think it was probably an unfortunate word to use, even though I feel that the government and the kind of politicians in general and of course the health board, everybody has really pulled together and done a great job. There's enormous cohesion, and I think that's one of the things we have found in Ireland, is this sense that we need each other, you know. As they say, or Scott Hakela Warren the Nina, that, you know, depending on each other we would survive, and that cohesion is not as evident in other, particularly in Britain, which is kind of frightening. But there's a huge cohesion here, and you'd be praising, you know, the government, even though you mightn't be politically for that particular party. The one mistake they made was using the word cocoon. Cocoon, like, it rhymes with buffoon and baboon. and it really is a word that's a first cousin to being a gobshite, an eejit, right? So it was a very silly word to go for. And I think that it also gives a sense of passivity, you know. So it feels like you're disabling people when you speak about them in the third person. Now, there was no other group was spoken about so much in the third person, right? Mm-hmm. So that people would say, well, there's issues now arising, let's say, for mothers with children, and we were talking to them, and they have said this, and they have said that, and the representative of the bereaved have said this, and everybody was speaking. But with the over 70s, they weren't in the conversation, they were being spoken about. The over 70s will be cocooning. So that's very disabling.
Yeah.
Now, that's all I'll say about it. It was the wrong word to go for, and I wouldn't be making a big deal about it, but it was not the best choice of word.
I knew you'd have a view on it because the word is a very powerful word. Like, it's a strong word. It's like a brand name. It's a lifestyle. And, you know, we know that people have been so compliant, I suppose, amazingly so. And, you know, we all rejoice in the fact that the other day there were no deaths registered in total the other day, and one can only celebrate at that. But I'm just interested in the language that has kind of cropped up around all this suddenly in the last few months. But as I said, let's sweep all that to the side and let's focus on the upper value, which is staring at lakes. And I read somewhere that it started out as a book about depression, a middle-aged man living in Ireland in the wake of the Celtic Tiger. And then it became a story about growing old, the essence of love and marriage, and sitting in cars staring at lakes. Does that mean to what you were doing and what you've written in Staring at Lakes, Michael?
Yeah, that's about it, really. And to be honest, it started a long time ago. I read, this may sound strange, but I read Mr. Pepys's diaries. They're kind of the 1600s in England, in London. And I, years and years ago, I used to love them because I felt that Mr. Pepys used to give us a kind of a chronicle of ordinary life in London at the time that was like hundreds of years later, it was the crucial one to read, you know. But he would talk about a coronation or a beheading in the same paragraph as he'd be mentioning that his dog was sick at lunchtime. And I thought, this is a beautiful thing to do. I've always lived in rural Ireland. I've lived in Donegal, Galway, Cavan, Leitrim, all these rural areas. I've spent my life in it. I love it. And I thought it'd be lovely to do a chronicle of ordinary life in Ireland. And it really started to survive. I thought, could I sell it to the Irish Times as an idea? And Geraldine Kennedy was the editor at the time, and she liked it, and she took it on. So that's like, I think, 15 years ago nearly. And that's really where it started. It started like to try and package together as a storyteller a chronicle of ordinary life as story. Because to me, like, I got tired with the novel. I wrote three novels, but and they were well received and all the rest of it. But I felt that there's something about the novel when you'd have a person who writes a novel and they're on the radio or the television and they're being interviewed and they're talking about things like, well, my characters, you know, and they're talking in the third person, let's say, about the main character. And, well, the main character is a bit of a nervous person. And I'm thinking, why am I listening to this? Why can't I turn over to some other channel and hear something real, something authentic? And when you look at the stories that came out in the 1990s, it was actually documentaries. It was people like, you know, people making documentaries about issues in Ireland, scandals and all the rest of it, that were telling stories. And and Joe Duffy was doing it on Liveline and programmes like that. And I saw that people have this insatiable need and desire to share stories, that is, to tell them and to listen to them. And that is the dynamic of literature. And the rest is simply, you know, publishers packaging things for tastes and commodities. And so I loved this idea for years and years. I was always trying to write my plays or write my fictions as close to the bone as that they were true. And therefore, it seemed to me I'd ultimately write a chronicle of ordinary life that would start with phrases like, I was looking at the bird on the tree this morning and I was feeling very happy. Now, I did that, but what then happened was after about, I don't know, it was about 4 years doing it in the Irish Times, the publisher, Ciara Dooley, was the editor who gave me an old email and said, did you ever think of, you know, evolving into a book of memoir like this? And I loved the idea, and I wrote Staring at Lakes as what was going to be the memoir and leave it like that. And I'm I'm now finishing book six of the memoir. It's a fierce long memoir, and there's nothing in it. But there is nothing in it. This is the joy of my life to share with people. The joy of my life to share with people is that, like, you know, it's not big things that matter. It's your life that matters. It's just being here now matters. And if a bumblebee, as happened last week, I was doing a podcast and there was a bumblebee came in and it started making noise when I was doing this kind of thing on a podcast. And I started talking about the bumblebee for about 20 minutes and how I felt about it. And that's as important as the big issues of politics and Dominic Cummings and all the rest of them. Do you know what I mean? Because we're here. And the way we show that we're here is by telling stories. Stories are like aeroplanes. They actually bring you into the present moment. So they're therapeutic skill to tell a story. You end up in a silence between one story and another. And that silence, we're here. I'm going on too long now.
You're not, but one of the things that I think is so interesting about the way you put yourself forward when you're speaking is that you make it seem so easy. And a lot of people watching this interview, you know, have had thoughts of maybe writing reminiscences or memoirs, or they're worried, you know, the stories are disappearing and that they'd like to chart them. In your case, when I read around this, I mean, you spoke, I think it was to Michelle Forbes, and you said, yes, it's a memoir, but actually it's a novel. But you're not really saying it's a novel. And that really struck me. I thought that's so interesting that there's absolute thought into the structure. If you're making it sound like a bumblebee came in and you just react to that, and of course you do so beautifully. But when you were committing to the page here, you did have a plan, a structure. There was a start, middle, end. There was a reason. You know, it wasn't just random.
Oh, absolutely.
So that's quite a rich experience for the reader, I think, because actually, subtly, you are actually writing a novel here with Staring at Lakes. Is that fair?
It's absolutely true that if I was to write the bumblebee into the next memoir or into a column next week, I would go through seven or eight drafts of the bumblebee. And I would pair every sentence to make sure every sentence was clear. And I would structure it that there was a beginning and a middle and an end. and there was a bit of a climax and there was a bit of a reversal. And I would use all the skills of storytelling that I would have used when I was writing stage plays or doing one-man shows or when I was acting or when I was writing novels. Yes, I mean, I've spent from 1984 full-time trying to study the craft of storytelling. And I'm a great admirer of the Italian man, Dario Fo. I mean, he's passed away now, but he wrote a great book called The Tricks of the Trade. And I just love that phrase, that that telling a story is a craft like playing a musical tune. And the same way as the musician rehearses the tune many, many, many times, I would rehearse my story about the bumblebee many times before I'd write it down. So I do bring craft, I hope, to it. And, you know, craft makes it look like there's no craft. So, yes, I mean, I hope you can read it like you can hear me talking, but I'm not a genius. I'm a very mediocre writer, I think, very mediocre person. And so I have to work very hard to get the craft right. And I passionately believe in craft, and I have no time for people who don't.
Well, taking that point, I want to talk to you about your opening line. I have a bit of a thing about opening lines, because I think the author spends so much time making sure they have the best opening line that it really reveals their hand in a way. I loved it because you have, if you don't mind, I'll just read it here. I can hear the porridge coming, and then it sounds, but who is this woman carrying my tray? And I just thought it was such a great opening section, because we assume that I'm bringing porridge into you in a tray is a partner or an intimate family member. And then you throw this on, and we're going, oh God, maybe he's in a B&B. But then you tell them not to open the curtains, and they ignore that and open the curtains anyway, which is only the sort of thing a family member or a loved one will do. And I just thought, this is in the first section, you've thrown domestic, you've thrown outsiders, you've given me total uncertain territory for a very simple scene. You receiving a tray of porridge in your bedroom. And I thought, I just loved that opening section. I thought, the reader does not know where they stand with it. This is great. Was that important to you?
Yeah, I mean, I would work at things like that. And thank you for saying that about it. I think that it opens something that maintains itself right through that book, and it is right through all the columns. I talk about my partner as the beloved. And I do that because it's like an archetype. It's like I'm not really talking about the individual. I'm married to Cathy Carman, who's a sculptor, and she has her own life and her own website and all the rest of it. But I don't talk about us in a personal way, but I do talk about me almost like the way my longings are, the way my desires are, or the way my sadness is. And one of the things that I think people feel sometimes is, for example, a sense of loneliness in marriage. Loneliness is a strange thing, and it comes to people. I've often seen it in people who are happily married for years, and yet inside one individual, there's a loneliness. There's another thing happens in marriage, and I think it's a very positive and beautiful thing, and that is when you realize after about 30 years, you're looking at her face on the pillow, and you realize you don't know her. You don't know her. That is a moment where your love is really getting someplace so deep that it's sacramental. It's the only word I could use for it. But, you know, young people think they know each other. They measure each other up and they do this, that and the other. And middle-aged people are still at it. But there's at some stage in the completed rapture of love, somebody is coming up the stairs and you're saying, who is this? Who really is she? I don't know. But it's like, that's a great, joyful place to be in. If you get about a couple of seconds of that every 6 months, you're doing really well, I think.
Because I listened back to an interview with you and Cathy with Miriam when the book came out.
Yeah.
And Cathy's in the studio with you. Lovely to hear her slightly eye-rolled version of you, which was quite entertaining. But she said, you said at one point, during love changes you, it offers you transformation. You change when their light shines on you. And I wondered, reading the book, is the book a way of working out the importance of love in your life? Like, should we all be trying harder to find it? I mean, you moved all the way to Mullingar nearly to explore the edges of it. You know, you don't see it as a selfish act, you see?
No, I see the storytelling as the way that we kind of we name who we are, and by the way we name who we are, we become who we are. Okay. Right? So, like, for example, number one, everybody in the morning looks in the mirror on their own, and they have a little private conversation that nobody else is there in the bathroom attending to. And it's usually setting up the shape of your story for the day. You tell yourself, oh, well, now I must go to the shop this morning, and, oh, I have to talk to that Harding fella at 12 o'clock, right? And you plan your day like a little story, and you're on your own. And so this is a thing we do, and this is where, when you talk about whether my books are like novels, well, they're memoirs, but I don't see a line anymore in modern literature between novel and memoir, or even other kinds of books. I mean, there are many Nobel Literature Award winners now who have been writing all sorts of different types of books. And there's a huge amount of people are quarrying their own life for stories, because we have lived through too much suffering in the 20th century. We are too aware. In the media is doing a lot of work for us that the novelists used to do. When Dostoevsky or Dickens was writing, they didn't have social media, never mind television and Netflix, right?
Yeah.
So it's kind of, it's almost like it becomes an exotic art form, writing novels, if it's already been done massively, furiously, powerfully elsewhere. And so, in a sense, the storyteller is forced back into her own life or his own life to quarry something that's really deeply and dynamically human. Now, when you tell stories, as I say, you're looking in the mirror, it's a dynamic of how you be human for the day. You're actually negotiating how you're going to get through the day. If you had somebody in hospital, you'd be there in the mirror thinking, what'll I say to her this morning? You're negotiating. This is really how we live. And if you, for example, if you choose to tell yourself negative things, it's strange the way you can become negative.
Yeah.
If you tell yourself, my next book is called What is Beautiful in the Sky? What is beautiful in the sky? Because I think that in this time of COVID, when there's all this idea of poison in the air, there's kind of a wonderful way to choose what is beautiful. And that's not soft or sentimental. To choose and find what's beautiful is the hardest thing you'll do, right? But this thing of, like, what you say about yourself does actually inform what you become. If you say, I don't like that person, and if you speak all sorts of negativity, you'll find your bones and your flesh beginning to get hard with negativity. As they say, the body holds the score, you know? But if you say, even if it's somebody that you really dislike, I did it the other night. I won't say, I'm only starting politics here, but I mean, I was looking at Cummins, you know, on his interview, and I was looking at him, and, like, they're just lining up now for a big hunt. He's the one they're now hunting. It's a kind of a big swarm. And I was looking at him and trying to say to myself, well, he's still a human being. He seems like an ordinary human being who's got the same worries and anxieties as I have. And the more you're kind of positive to somebody, even if you don't like them, you kind of physically get better. You feel lighter in yourself. You're not carrying it around with you. Right? So that's all old wisdom. I mean, any old granny will tell you that. You know? And so we need to listen more to granny.
Well, the grannies, you know, the Celia Guires and all that, all the different older women in your book are really striking. But can we just, I just want to talk a little bit about, going back to the start with the title itself. I found all the way through, I was underlining when the word lake was mentioned, and then suddenly you explained the title, you know, halfway through. It's a version taken to the bed, you know, it's that thing of sort of just, I don't know, depression taking over, a paralyzing kind of experience. Did you deliberately wait till later in the book to explain that to us? Because it suddenly comes like a bullet nearly, you know?
No, I can't say that I can't say that I did anything deliberate in the writing of the book, because the way that I tend to write is I will write a draft and then I redraft. So the first draft, I don't start with a structure as a lot of people would. I start with maybe a very rough beginning, middle, and end, and it might be only 5,000 words, let's say.
Yeah.
And gradually, I knit it. I get little bits of it inside it, and I say, oh, there's a nice moment. So I try and let it grow organically. And therefore, yeah. I really don't know what it's about until I'm finished it. I really don't. And with the staring at lakes, there was two sides to that as well. One was that there is a kind of a sort of a darkness to the way people in depression stare at the lake. I've seen it all my life because I grew up in Cavan. We have 364 lakes in Cavan, and there's a good few in Leitrim as well. And a lot of people, you know, in the terrible disasters of suicide, use the river or the lake as a solution. And I know that myself, I have often got comfort when I was sort of in a morbid or melancholic mood, even as a young fella. I used to love going out to the lake and just hanging around the lake. And there's something about the lake and the water that's like motherly. You know, it like when some people go to the lake, it is for comfort. And when I do it myself, just to go to a lake, I love to be at the lake. I love to be at a river. There is a beautiful sense of being nurtured, right? But that would be the dark side of staring at a lake when you're depressed. The beautiful side of it came to me when the lady wife in my depression looked at me one day in the kitchen in Mullingar, and she'd talk about it afterwards and say, when she looked, she thought, what'll I do with this fella? And she said, will we go for a spin in the car? And that's something like that went out of fashion in 1958. You know, in the old days, people would go for a spin in the car and just do nothing except look out the glass window of the car at the lake. But when she said this to me, she said, your face lit up. The amazing joy of, oh gosh, we'll go and have a look at the lake. And there I was, sitting in the car with the woman I love. What were we doing? Looking at a lake, nothing else. And it was like a moment of pure bliss, pure happiness to realize there's nothing in life that you need to actually achieve happiness or wisdom. It's all just be in the present moment, just sit there. So that's the two sides. Staring at a lake can be a kind of thing people do to console themselves when they're sad and melancholic, but it can also be an experience of sheer bliss.
Actually, listening to you, it has struck me that about 3 or 4 weeks into the lockdown, when we were restricted within our 2K, I thought, isn't the idea of just going for a spin the most glamorous, exotic sounding experience? Yeah. Now they do have two boys to just put them in the car, yeah, and go for a spin. Suddenly, yeah, seemed like this stunning experience, and
it's amazing.
It's so lovely and that you're framing it. That's how I felt. I thought, yeah, God, there's the freedom in just going for a spin. Yeah. And I've never noticed it before until I couldn't do it.
I know. It's amazing. And everybody is experiencing that. And it's, you know, there's different levels of this whole transformation that the globe is going through. And that's what it is. It's a global transformation, bigger than anything in hundreds of years. Maybe it's like a big ice age or something. But this tiny little virus is changing everything. And it is bringing huge suffering, but it's also bringing, I don't know, a sense of relationship and joy into lives in Western culture that I think had lost it. Don't know.
It's funny you're talking about car, because that was one of the questions I wanted to talk to you about. In the book, there are very funny references to cars and how you see them as this kind of, or you thought, an external symbol of success or aspiration. And the Jeep, for example, you're very entertaining about talking about the Jeep and what it meant during that time. But reading the book about the Celtic Tiger during this time was particularly poignant, actually, because you really saw vacuous the Celtic Tiger was, you know, particularly now when things are so kind of small and precious. But just for readers who loved the book, maybe talk to us a little bit about Mullingar and what that exodus to Mullingar meant for you and how you think about it now.
Well, I tell the story in the book, which is a true story, but I tell it for fun. And this is where, when you're telling your own life story, you do also shape it and structure it like a, you know, that like a novel. So I tell the story that I left because of the dishwasher. And
I love
it. I always wanted to, you know, you always have fantasies as a writer of living in somewhere like Paris. And I spent 3 or 4 months in Paris in 20 years ago, and I wrote a book in it. I wrote a novel called Bird in the Snow in the Centre Culturel Irlandais over there. So you'd be always fantasizing about that, and you're living in Leitrim. And we got a dishwasher, and the lady wife would put in the dishes, and then I'd put in a few, and then I'd turn it on, and she'd say, "Don't turn it on yet, it's not full." And it was like she had a way of doing it, and she stuffed everything in, like she'd pack in saucers and just like crazy. And I think, why can't we just put it in, like, without stuffing it and put it on? It'll be done in an hour. What's the problem? And anyway, so I made the joke. I didn't think it'd be such a big deal, but I made the joke in the book that, well, it was a good reason to go to Mullingar. Like, Mullingar was in Paris, but at least I could have my own dishwasher. And so I said it like that. And when I was doing the book, the book was published and I was going around the country, like doing a tour and signing copies, it was like the amount of people who came up to me and they'd women, men, and they'd whisper when they'd be getting the signing done, "We have a dishwasher issue in our house." And I was thinking, geez, I could make a living doing therapy groups for people who have problems with dishwashers. And largely, it's just one of those simple things that both people always have a pernickety way of doing it. Now, we have those things about loads of stuff, but we can usually have doubles, you know. Like, mm-hmm. You could have your towel and I'll have my towel, but, mm-hmm. but I have to share the dishwasher. And so that's how I talked about leaving and going to Mullingar. And it allowed me to write about Mullingar, number one, in a way that was enthusiastic, that in a way that I was marveling. So it had the flavour of, you know, the cat goes to London to see the Queen. And it also had the irony that I was able to walk around Mullingar and say things like, you know, Mullingar is really the Prague of Ireland.
Do you know? You called it sexy.
What?
You say it's sexy in the book.
Oh, it is. But Mullingar is sexy. Mullingar, if you've lived in, when you've lived in Leitrim for about 10 years, I tell you, Mullingar is seriously sexy. Do you know?
Excellent. I love
and
that.
I tell you one thing about Mullingar and Westmead in general. Well, I'll tell you a couple of things about it. I can't stop talking, you see that. But my mother, Finlay was her name, but her mother was Elizabeth Lynch. And Elizabeth Lynch, my grandmother, came originally from a townland called Anchorland in Westmead, right? And so I think there was a kind of an energy there that I connected with. And funny enough, my mother ended up in the nursing home in Newbrook in Mullingar for her last 4 or 5 years before she passed away. And I don't know, there's funny cycles in life and circles and patterns. You know, there's like patterns on the beach. And you think somebody consciously drew them, but they didn't. It's the cosmos just arranged it like that. And they arrange your life like that sometimes as well. You don't have to extrapolate some sort of meaning in it, but they're beautiful patterns in life. And that was a nice one I felt for my mother, and the closure of her life was in a very beautiful place, but it was also very close to where her heart was, you know. As a young girl, she'd be telling us, many as the time she'd tell us about the boys she used to fall in love with, around Castle Pollard. And they'd be waiting, the girls would be waiting on the square in Castle Pollard for the boys to leave home the cattle. They'd be hanging around for about an hour, waiting for the boys to come back, you know. "Oh, Harry, just accidentally happened to be here." "We're not here to be looking at you, no." So I loved Mullingar for one other reason, and that was Mullingar people and Westmead people would talk to you all the time. So that, for example, I'm in Arigna, and Arigna is a very, very beautiful place. It's where the miners' tradition was, coal miners for centuries, but, and I love it here. And I say that I'm in Leitrim because every townland around me is Leitrim. Every field. If I walk out there for 20 metres, I'm in Leitrim. So that's why I say I'm in Leitrim, even though I'm in Arigna. But to talk about Leitrim people, they don't tell you much.
Mm.
You know, Leitrim people, they don't like loose talking. They're very understated. And you'd be driving up and down the road, and after about 20 years, you know, you'd get... You know, be driving... You know the steering wheel? And then they go... Really understated now.
Yeah.
And if you said to somebody, when I used to go to the sauna, I used to go to swimming pools in different places, and I'll never be doing it again, I suppose, because it'll all be closed. But I'd go to the sauna and I used to love chatting, provoking people. You know, I'd be there and there'd be some local and you'd say something like, is this hotel in Nama? Right? And if you said that now in Leitrim, the answer you would get would be pure silence. Yeah. Pure silence. Mm-hmm. And eventually they might say, oh, I don't know. You know, try the same thing, you know, a gossipy question in the sauna in somewhere like Mullingar. You know, there might be a big flashy car outside, big Mercedes or something. Or there might be some well-known fella, you know, a businessman maybe at the lunch or maybe in the pool. You'd be looking out the glass and he'd be swimming around like a big whale, right? Some big businessman. And you'd look out and you'd say to the fella beside you, is Joe there? You know, is that Joe over there? Is he in Nama? And they'd say to you, this is a true story, they'd say to you, oh, listen, not only is he in Nama, but the wife is a big white Mercedes. And they just tell you everything. And now that was the same as Cavan, right? So I grew up with a mother who never stopped talking. Never. I mean, she would drive you crazy. You couldn't get a word in edgeways for about 40 years. But when she died, I realized I've lost the best storyteller I ever met. You know.
But you portray your relationship with her as very complex, Michael. I mean, you know, her threats to leave, to go away. When you write about her, you tie her up a little bit with some of the sadness you feel about characters like, or people like Father Fingers, for example. I mean, it's a tough emotional childhood landscape you're writing there and capturing, and not an unfamiliar one, I imagine, for many readers. But let's talk about your mum for a minute. I take all that, but that's not necessarily just the one side we get from her from the book. We get a very complex, it sounds like a woman who's very frustrated, actually.
Mm. I think that after that book, I knew I had to write a book about her. Mm. And the book that follows Staring at Lakes is Hanging with the Elephant. Mm. And it is really totally about my mother. Mm. It tracks from when she died to the autumn after she died, about 2012. Her house was in Cavan, and it was empty, obviously, because she had been in the nursing home. And I went over to it, and I actually spent a month in it, like living in it on my own. Okay. And I would come back home here on the weekends, and I would go into it like on a Sunday evening, like to work, and to be with her. And to meditate on the relationship we had and to write the story of it. And that story is nearly fully in Hanging with the Elephant. Mm. It's a big, 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 long story. It's another story. But I think what I learned through that book was the process that even though some of us may have very complex childhoods and very, I didn't have a disturbed childhood, by the way. I got the perfect middle-class childhood. I just wanted a big, culty country childhood, and they gave me a big, nice middle-class childhood, right? I think that was the essence of my melancholy and sadness and inability to communicate with my mother. I don't know, but I felt when I went to Glengevlin in West Cavan at 21 years of age, I came alive. I said, this is home. I couldn't understand it. I felt this is where I always was or something. and not just in Cavan. But I think my mother was also constrained by the manners and mannerisms. And so there was a great soul in her that only rarely got out. And I got glimpses of it. You know, there were wonderful times where I would see her storytelling side or her wild side. Yeah. And it would make you sad. Sometimes, again, just when you see a person like a parent and their life is passed without anybody ever telling it, without everybody any recording it, and you see a glimpse into their life, that they had a heart the same as you have, that they thought their life was precious the same as you do, that they struggled to be loving the same as you do, and that they failed. And then you think, and I think that's compassion, you think, you know, I can't say the word, but it's like, oh, gee, you know, and that makes you sad. And I think particularly with a parent, because you can never be a friend to a parent. And I think a parent can never be a friend to a child. You know, I think it's always dangerous. It always can turn out dodgy because you can't share their life. I have beautiful children, two children, really. We have, you know, a daughter between us. And then Kathy has a son who's like a stepson, but he's in his 40s now. But like, they live their life, and sometimes to be doing things, and you kind of like nearly to be with them or to start sentences with like, oh, well, yes, I remember being there when I was in my, you know.
Yeah.
And you have to say, no, you know, she'll discover London on her own. She'll discover England on her own. She doesn't need you to be telling her, well, actually, you can get such and such there because we used to always go there. You know, you have it, and it's kind of sad. You have to let them go, and that's the way you have to do it. It liberates you as well, I think. You know the thing I said about the parent, like about, we'll say, I'm in the bed and the lady wife is coming up the stairs, and you say, who is that person coming up? I think that's a lovely feeling to have with your children as well. You know, who are you? And have a joy in that. You don't know them. You don't presume to know them. They're a completely different cosmos.
Can I talk to you then about father fingers? Because probably the generation I'm at, I actually get a knot in my stomach when I read those kind of experiences that children had in school. Profoundly distressing for kind of our generation to think we were so close to that kind of experience in school, what should be such a positive, joyous, you know, situation. Is he an every man of that kind of priest, or that kind of teacher for you? And you obviously went to the absolute other direction when you became an educationalist. What does father fingers mean to you now at this stage of your life?
The father fingers is like a kind of an, is a kind of a template for the abusive person in religious authority. Yeah. And I think that I tried to make it as much a kind of a template as I could, because it's an archetype that everybody can identify.
Yeah.
And so what I think I was trying to do, I'd already written a lot about that as plays. I had written three plays in the Abbey about abusive clergy. One started with Una Puka, the second was Misogynist, and the third was Sour Grapes. And they were a kind of trilogy in the late 80s and 90s. And they covered loads of stuff, but the kind of whole story of that kind of thing of abuse by clergy. And I suppose it was inevitable. I didn't even have to think big about it or something, or decide it. Like, it was inevitable that if I was telling the story of my childhood, you'd have to put in some archetype without going too, again, deep. You know, you're writing it, you're editing it, you're rewriting it. So you're not going to, there's enough people would have told their own personal stories. So I felt, well, I don't want to add anything as from my personal history, but I do want to acknowledge that template, that archetype was in everybody's landscape. And it terrified us to the point that, yes, you could talk about really terrible stories of abuse. right? And I was more, I suppose, in Staring at Lakes and in all the other books, I'm always trying to tell the story of how you resolve the darkness rather than telling stories that just bear witness to the darkness. So that's a job for other writers and other storytellers and documentary and all the rest of it, and they do it powerfully, where they bear witness to the darkness in general, whether it be, you know, it could be child sexual abuse in our childhood, but it could be something even worse now, whatever. But that is something that people, writers, do. And then what I do as a writer is try and go beyond just bearing witness to the accused, but rather, what is my journey to set myself free from the things that make me angry? That would be a big deal for me. And there's a lovely, wonderful, amazing poet in Britain called, his name is Lem Sissé. Don't know if you ever heard of him. Lem Sissé is Chancellor of, I think, Manchester University. He'd be a kind of real cool dude. You'd see him in the media. And he's written astonishingly beautiful poetry books. And he's hugely eloquent in his poems and in his books about his abuse. Now, his abuse was horrific and terrible and all the rest of it. It was very much to do with religion. But he's passionate about the idea that the journey is to liberate yourself from your own anger and from your own hatred. And don't let it pull you down, you know? So that's something I think that I try and do. It's not a big deal for me looking at the Father Fingers character. There's other stories, like with the mother even. But I'm always in every book trying to find how we resolve our lives beautifully. How we find what is beautiful in the sky. Because we're dealing with a lot of toxicity, but I firmly believe that there is a kind of a way that the human being can actually find beauty. And it's very close to what I would have always believed, which was the sense of a transcendent being, a sense that we are nurtured and loved in the cosmos. You know? I don't adhere to any particular religion or faith tradition at this stage in my life, but I love them all. I find Islam, Buddhism, Christianity hugely enriching to me as a human being. And I think that there are ways even beyond religion, because religion has hugely made a problem for itself in excluding women. But I think that there are really beautiful, powerful ways, both inside religion and outside religion, to find what I would call prayer. To find life as a prayer, cooking as a prayer, minding the child as a prayer, writing books as prayers. It all becomes like some way of you're surfing your life. It's not really true and real. You're surfing it. It's like, there's a great line in Sufi, in the Islam tradition, I am not the lover, I am the loving. You know, we're just being, and we're in relationship with each other, and that's actually what we're floating on. You don't have to be thinking, what's the bottom of the lake? We're floating. It's okay.
That tied beautifully with a question that we got in from somebody who's watching tonight, a reader, James O'Keefe, and he wants me to put this question to you, which I think now might be a nice, elegant time to do it. It chimes in nicely with where our conversation has gone. But he says, Nietzsche had a famous aphorism that stated, become what you are. And what he wants to ask Michael is, he says, does Michael believe that having lived such a varied life, both spiritually and actually, that he's, and artistically, that he has become what he should be? I think emphasis on should. Or is there another Michael Hart possibly out there?
It's an interesting question. You'd think the answer was yes, you know, that that you become what you should be. But it's the word should is the mistake. So I think maybe the questioner probably had that in his mind. You know, he knows the answer is no, because there is nothing you should be. There's no should. That's the one key. And to become what you are is to become what you are. It's not to become what you should be.
Mm-hmm.
The should is like one of the worst one of the worst words you could use. And there's a lovely thing I always think about. The Heart Sutra is a beautiful text in Indian Hindu tradition or Buddhist tradition. The Heart Sutra says, at the end of it, it says, the ultimate teaching is that there is no teaching. Right? That is where we are. You can use some thing like psychotherapy, or you can use your story, or you can use religion to get you through the day. But it's not the truth. It's only a mechanism. It's a psychotherapy to allow you be here now. If it allows you to be here now, you're already enlightened. You don't need anything. You're happy. You're you. You're here. And when you say you're you, you don't even know who you is. Because if you said, well, I am me, Michael, and that was a whole baggage of, well, then I should be Michael. You know, if I went out into the garden and I wasn't Michael, well, that would be a problem.
Yeah.
And one of the most controlling things you can say to somebody in a relationship is something like, I don't know who you are today now. You're not being yourself, right? But the most liberating thing you can say to somebody is, I don't know who you are today, and it's wonderful. You know, so the should, you don't should anybody. You don't have to say you should be something. That's my feeling about it.
I think young teenagers have a very irritating phrase, which is, you know, living your best life. And I think for us, the older generation, I think that's what James maybe's coming at. You know what I mean? Have all the decisions you've made, all the journeys, the cul-de-sacs, the diversions, the roundabouts, the late staring, has it led to the person that, you know, the best version of yourself that you could be sitting here today?
Oh, well, the answer to that is no, it hasn't, because I made all the wrong moves. And I believe that. And I say it all the time. It's like such an important way of thinking. God Almighty, if you were living your best self, and if you're affirming yourself so much that your fists are getting clenched, you're really not well. You're not well, no matter what age you are. If you say to yourself, I say to myself, you know, I failed, like, I had a lot of different experiences in life because I failed at them all. I failed at being a teacher. I failed at being a priest. I failed at being a social worker. I failed at being a writer. I failed at being a playwright. So everything is a failure. And when you get to about, I'm 67, so when you get to 70 maybe, you're kind of looking at it, physically, you know, your life is beginning to fail. Your eyesight's getting a bit weaker. I'm not able to walk up the hill the way I used to, and I got a stent in last year. So, sure, as the countryman would say, sure, he's failing. He's beginning to fail a bit. Now, how can we make that we give ourselves permission to fail? And it's just letting go of all these templates, like your best self, or the things that I should be doing. You know, I should be writing this type of book, or I should be doing more of this, that, and the other. There's no need to do anything. You give yourself permission to be as you are with all your failures, and that with all those failures, you are lovable. You are delightful. That's all.
You said earlier that you write in some way to try and resolve the darkness, not just to bear witness. I think your last piece there brings us very neatly to that conclusion, actually.
Yeah, I think that the book that I'm doing at the minute is, is very much because of COVID-19, I'm very much trying to make a final kind of attempt to express the feeling of positive joy that I think comes to somebody my age who's heading for 70 and hoping to survive another few years. But there is a really beautiful way to live that is about letting go of things. And it's about choosing in the whole shape of your life a narrative about it that is beautiful. I mean, I'll just give you one last example of it. You'd be talking, I've often had this experience. You'd be at a dinner table, more years ago than now, but you'd be at the dinner table and somebody'd be telling you the life story, right? And they'd be saying, I had the job to get the manager's job, and then this one came in and I didn't get it, and I was really annoyed at that time. And oh no. And then they tell you, well, I started up this company with the car sales, and you know, it's all right, except I'm working with this guy and I can't stand him. He's an awful man. Right. So do you know what I'm saying? The script they have, the title on it is Life is Awful.
Yeah.
And then you start playing with them. You start saying, your wife, I was talking to your wife there, and she's a great woman, great cook. And he says, oh yeah, she's amazing. I wouldn't have got through without her, you know. And you start picking the nice things, right?
Yeah.
And at the end of the night, he's on the next bottle of wine and he's kind of getting a bit teary and he's saying things like, you know, life has really been good to me. And he's actually changed the narrative. Mm. He's begun to choose. There's another thing you can do. I found it like, again, I used to do it with my mother. Sometimes as people get older, they can remember things that hurt them, and because they didn't resolve them, they're still there hurting them, right? And it might be like, an example of it would be when my mother was in her 80s, you might get her into the lift going up to Dunn Stores in Cavan, and somebody would get into the lift that she didn't like, and she wouldn't speak to them. And when she'd get out, then we'd be going along in Dunn Stores along the aisles, and I'd say, you're not speaking to whoever, you know? Or that one, she'd say. And she'd tell you something that the woman did to her 50 years ago. Right? And, you know, memories of negative things can annoy people. And you can annoy somebody, you just mention it to them and they're annoyed for the day. But yeah. It works the opposite way as well. Because I used to say to my mother in those situations, we'd be out then having a cup of tea after the message. And we'd be in the Farnham Arms Hotel or somewhere. And I would say to her something like, did you ever come in here as children, Mammy?
Yeah.
And she'd face it light up and she'd say, oh, we used to try and get up the stairs, but they wouldn't let us, you know. And she'd be suddenly into all the stories. And that's an amazing thing that every individual has, is the ability to remember hurt or sometimes work through the hurt, acknowledge it, but also choose what is beautiful and dwell on it, because that too is real. And you become the person tomorrow because of what you think about today.
I think we all have that experience of, you know, those stories that we remember, but very few of us tell it as beautifully and elegantly as you. And we just thank you. I'm going to leave it there, Michael. Thank you so much. That was fascinating and very compelling. And I just want to thank you for your honesty and your generosity, I suppose, in our conversation today under very extremely weird circumstances. But thank you so much, Michael.
Thank you. And thanks, Evelyn. Thanks, everybody, for being here. Bye-bye.